We are rolling.
It's always take two. We need to do better about making sure that the first time feels like the second time.
We? You got a mouse in your pocket?
Okay, fine. Welcome, everybody, to season three, a little bit more laid back for season three, more like, you know, live to radio, sort of me exercising my live skills, you exercising your live skills. So
cool.
I'm looking forward to more laid back season three. How about we let the people hear this new theme of yours that you composed for season three?
Hit it.
Think that sounds great.
Yeah, Evan, we're gonna have Evan mix everything down for us, but that's all the nuts and bolts, featuring prominently the birthday gift that you and Dell got for me, the MXR talk box,
all of these different tools and contraptions.
If we're not careful, we're gonna end up with a production house.
We need one at this point. I'm Garrett, by the way. My name is Garrett.
I'm Scott Blankenship.
And this is Trilloquy. This is a podcast that takes the phrase classical music and applies it more equitably, more 21st century. There's been all of these centuries of using that phrase in conjunction with the aesthetics of Western Europe and all of that stuff. And on this podcast, we just try to break all of that up by acknowledging all of the classic music of America and all around the world.
And we certainly don't shy away whenever these topics intersect with other genres. I would point everybody to the Trilloquy Tracks playlists, which has all the tracks that Spotify carries that we reference within the Opus.
Mm-hmm.
And it is a wide and deep list.
Yep.
You should check it out.
Yeah, and we're in Black History, Black Music Month, rather, officially June. So we're going to be talking about some black music today. The guest today, Dr. Durell Cooper, is a specialist in hip-hop. We get into hip-hop, the philanthropy that lives inside of hip-hop, the activism, the cognitive things for the developing mind and musicians, all sorts of really great stuff. What sort of music did you have to bring in today, sort of letting people know what's coming?
As people hear this, we will be into Black History Month, but as we record it, we're on the last day of Mental Health Awareness Month. Mm-hmm. And so I want to just tap in on a wave that hit me earlier last week, and the music and the way that I use the music to get through it. So we're going to listen to Nat King Cole singing What'll I Do?
Yeah, absolutely. Before we get into it, I want to give a shout out to the Black Opera Alliance for their continued support. Lots of really incredible things happening over there. You can find out what's going on at blackoperaalliance.org. Also follow the Black Opera Alliance on all of the socials, Facebook and Instagram. I also want to give a shout out to Emma, who put me on to this website. Scott, this database of black businesses to be supported. Mm. As we're recording this, it's the 100th anniversary of the tragedy at Greenwood down there in Tulsa. So the more people are talking about black business and supporting black, I think is really important to point, you know, folks toward that. So mm-hmm. there will be a link to that in the description of this. I think one thing that we have pulled over from season two is really dragging out these intros. Where we at? How far into it are we?
4 minutes.
Okay, let's go ahead and start movement one. I got to get used to this live button pressing and all of that stuff again. I'm getting these exercises going. One of the reasons I'm so inspired to sort of give this podcast for season three a slightly looser feel, recording music and sound live to tape, is because I hear a lot of other folks doing that, including, you know, who is known by many as the Podfather, mm-hmm. who I go to always when I talk about some of my podcast inspirations, Joe Budden. Scott, we have incredible, impeccable timing on this podcast. As soon as we talk about something,
then
it goes
happens.
Left or something happens. So at the end of season two, a few weeks ago, we were talking about how how the Joe Button podcast is just such a great example of how you can match friendship with business and really, you know, just broaden your world and bring you and your friends up together through some project you have. Well, the day, and I mean the day after we recorded, the news broke that they had broken up. I'll put a link to some of the things in the description of this. What I wanted to ask you, Scott, and we kind of talked about this during our break, you know, during our huddles where we weren't taping, money getting in the way of a project and the growth of a project, even our friendship. For folks who have no idea what the news surrounding the whole Joe Button thing was, allegedly, what I'm hearing is that the co-hosts were on a percentage-based pay scale, and when it came time for them to want to match what they were bringing home, and the percentage you were supposed to be with the bigger numbers and the bigger picture, Joe felt like they didn't need that information, and they were overstepping, and one thing led to another, and we have a whole different show over there now. If I, at one point, you know, when we're making all the money like they are, and I offer you
all the money?
Maybe a portion of the money they're making, but an X percent of, you know, I say at the end of the day, you are getting X percent of this money, and it ends up being, you know, not chump change. Let's say I get to pay you $25,000, $30,000 a month. We're not making that, by the way. Let me make sure that's clear. But just in this situation, I'm paying you $30,000 a year, and let's say that's supposed to be 40% of, you know, everything that's being raked in. At what point, and this is my take, at what point is that $30,000 gonna feel like not enough money, or that amount feels like I need to double check to make sure that, you know, this is actually fair for a salary that can pay you and more to live, you know, you're comfortable. Would you ever feel like you needed to double check? My thing was I don't feel like I would need to, but
anytime it's a percentage, yeah, I want to know. And there's no amount of money that is going to change my mind on that front, because if you tell me that you're going to give me a percentage and then you don't show me what the number was, that's where I have a problem. Now, where I work now, they give me X dollars a year in salary. I don't need to see their numbers because we both agreed that this is what they were going to pay me.
Right.
So that is where the sticking point comes for me. Now think the opposite direction. What if you promise to pay me, what if my agreement was $50,000 a year to do this podcast, and then the underwriters don't come?
Right.
And the donations aren't as big as maybe you would have hoped.
Yeah.
Well, you told me you were going to give me $50,000.
Right.
What if you ended up with 20 then?
Well, my thing is, that would be my responsibility. It would be up to me to do everything I can.
So you're going to be outselling.
I would have to be doing something. The point I want to make, though, is $50,000 a year to do a podcast is one thing. These guys,
they're doing millions.
Have still a lot of money, and we aren't talking about 40 hours a week either. You know, no shade, not to diminish the work it takes to produce a podcast, but at the end of the day, you know, they were doing, you know, around 3 hours twice a week, so six, let's add production, let's say 15 hours a week tops, and you're bringing home and you're bringing home that kind of money. I don't know, for me, I would chill, but armchair quarterback, as you say.
No, for me, it's just the percentage, because what
just sticking
happens,
to that part of the thing, because, just sticking to it.
And, you know, what would happen if, and this is a great example, if something happened where one of us pissed the other one off, and let's say that this was my project, and I'm looking at all these millions of dollars that are coming in, and I go, well, I know that I said I was going to give Garrett 30%, but instead I'm just going to give him $10 million because I put him here, and he should be happy with that. Okay, you wouldn't like that, right?
I don't know, $10
million. But what if I brought in $100 million and you should get 30 then?
I hear you. What we're boiling down to is how, you know, money just makes things way more complicated in
it does.
In different ways.
And I have one
a lot of money.
I have one other experience from back in my mobile DJ days. Shout out to Steve Bergeron, who started his own mobile DJ company, and I was his other guy. Mm-hmm. It was just the two of us, and I hated doing it. The reason being is because every time we saw each other, all we were doing was talking about the business.
Right.
Now, you and I do this different because we've got social time and we send texts and, you know, share videos and all that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. So there's the friendship stuff that's going on behind the scenes. And then on Mondays, it's head down, pencil up, doing the work.
Right. But, head down, pencil up.
Right. But, you know, back in the day when he was paying me.
I was a little late. Head down, pencil up, you get it.
I get it.
Instead of, anyway, go ahead. Yep.
No, that was the only point that I was trying to make is that, you know, do you think that their relationship is going to survive the dust up?
Well, that's what this article is about that I had pulled up here that I'll have in the description. Can you scroll up? What's the headline to this? This is from Complex. It says, Joe Budden says he's happy for Rory and Maul. Those are his previous co-hosts. So they've gone on to start their own projects, and they have this video promo that's actually pretty funny. You know, Rory and Maul on a job interview. It's time to look for another job or whatever. Right. So, you know, on the last episode of his podcast, he talks about how he's happy for them and all of that sort of thing. I think it's important to talk about here and across the podcast sphere, because as we see more podcasts, as more of us are beginning to have actual relationships with these shows. You were talking about a Sopranos podcast that you're into. You know, if they get into it, if those hosts get into some spats about something, I'm sure there's a part of you that still wants your podcast. It's time for them to get themselves together. Mm-hmm. And, you know, really, we're trained as broadcasters to think about the audience. So anyway, I think my bigger point is all of the folks trying to create content, do podcasts and that sort of stuff out there, whether you're in so-called classical music or not, these are conversations, these are parameters that I think need to be laid out before anything happens, before Trilloquy was pulling in any independent revenue. When I was still at Minnesota Public Radio, we talked about how, okay, if one of us gets to go rogue and be on our own, it should be me first and da-da-da. Mm-hmm. That process happened a little quicker than we expected.
It's weird, right?
But here we are. What's your advice to folks out there doing podcasts and other maybe starting chamber groups or whatever with their friends when it comes to laying this stuff out at the beginning, starting some sort of project that could manifest in some money and opportunity and other things? Mm-hmm. What sorts of conversations do you think need to be clear before they get going?
The simplest is what you just said. You have that preliminary conversation where you lay out the what ifs.
Yeah.
Or I guess I should say the if thens. But you know, I want to point out here that also money still isn't an issue, because all of the donations that come through the Trilloquy website, that's still Garrett's living. I'm not pulling from that.
And quite frankly, more than 50% of that money goes right back into Trilloquy.
Right. So, you know? So basically what I'm saying is that the podcast and Garrett is who benefits from this. So there was never any question about what I would get.
Yeah.
You know, so that relieves a big amount of the pressure. Mm-hmm. But I think that as long as you have some sort of an agreed upon, you know, let's call it a mini constitution or, you know, whatever your mission statement on your masthead is.
Yeah.
As long as you've got that, then, you know, you can point to it and go, remember when we agreed to this? I don't know if that would work in every instance, but it's a start. It's a way.
Especially as outside is starting to open back up. A lot of people figured out how to make money in really unique ways during COVID, right?
And the NFTs and
All of that stuff. So as we're coming back outside and people are collaborating and continuing all of this entrepreneurial stuff that was going down during quarantine, again, whether it's a podcast, a chamber group, whatever, there are conversations that need to be cleared so that we don't see, you know, all of this stuff that Joe's going through. You mentioned Mental Health Month. Mm-hmm. He brought his therapist on. Like, this has been a big thing. And as one of the biggest podcasts out there, I think it's some news that all podcasters should at least be aware of.
Would you do that?
Would I bring my therapist on? No. My therapist is not coming on Trilloquy.
What about the, what's the payment for the special? Not OnlyFans. That's for...
Oh, it's not. Oh, well, OnlyFans isn't necessarily for the sexy stuff, but
oh, Patreon.
Oh,
there
Patreon.
We go.
Yeah, yeah, so yeah, maybe that'd be some Patreon content. Actually, some of my sessions would, if you put some bed music, sound effects, that's a podcast.
Damn. All right.
Anyway, that gets a natural for me. That's our sound for a natural. Okay. So when we go back and add on to something we talked about previously or fix something we said, well, we'll add that little pretty sound to it. So a natural to that. To transition us into our next accidental out of that natural, you suggested that we listen to a little Brahms, some of the violin concerto. Could you talk about the context of that within the conversation of friendship and reconciliation?
Josef Joachim and his wife weren't getting along, and they were starting the divorce proceedings, and Joachim thought that Brahms would be his buddy and back him up.
He thought,
you know, right. and Brahms went, actually, you know, I kind of agree with your wife.
Oh.
And Joachim was like, all right, I'm out. So they were done. And the violin concerto was written as sort of an olive branch, you know, to say, mm-hmm. Hey, would you come on? Let's be buddies again. You know, I don't know if it worked, but well, and I don't think he played it.
Y'all know how I feel about Brahms.
I do.
But I think that's a great story. Here's a little bit of that that Brahms as we get to our next accidental. Like to talk about all the time anyway is that whole love triangle, wasn't it? Brahms and then
Schumann and Clara Wieck,
the Schumanns. Mm-hmm. Nim. I don't like the idea of somebody waiting in the wings for me to get out of the way. So
for
when
you
I
to die.
So when I die, they can come over here with Dell. Or I don't like that. I don't like that. And that was Brahms. Y'all are supporting somebody waiting in the dirty mackin', as they say today.
Well, there's also, you know, from the woman's perspective, you know, Clara might have been keeping Johannes in the back pocket, you know, kept on hold.
Look,
have you seen that beard?
I'm sure Brahms was a looker in some context, in some way. Or
I try to remind myself that everybody is attracted to somebody.
You're right. Even Brahms.
Oh, even Brahms. You know, I mistook him for Karl Marx once.
he reminds me of the architect off the Matrix.
Really?
Someone to not, you know, the beard and the and the stoic. Anyway, so let's get into this into this next accidental. I'm going to give a big flat sharp to this news article from where's my sharp button? That's the sharp button for good things. This is an article from CNN. Can you scroll up to that headline? It says, black classical artists are turning the pain of the Tulsa race massacre into music. Before we get into the subject matter specifically, the Tulsa race massacre, the Greenwood tragedy, we've talked a little bit about how that's a bit of history that has sort of slipped through the cracks for most of us.
Slipped through the cracks, it was
ignored.
Buried.
And how you learned about it first from
The Watchmen.
What were reprise that for us. What was your reaction? You saw this event being depicted and you were like, what?
My jaw was in my lap watching how gruesome the opening of the first episode of Watchmen was. Mm-hmm. And I thought, my goodness, this is, I knew that it was like sort of an alternate history mm-hmm. timeline.
Yeah.
But I didn't know that the Tulsa riot, that the Tulsa massacre was real. So in the moment, I was thinking that that was done for the television show. So imagine how appalled I was to find out that that actually happened. And it was just never covered. I mean, I would have remembered that.
We all would have, right?
Did you get it in school?
No, absolutely not.
Why not?
And I was actually trying to think about it today. Like, when was the first time I heard about it? And I'm going to shout out one of my friends, Lawrence Naff. Quick side note, it's weird how in the year 2021, there are people that I have known for 20, 25 years only on the internet, you know, from the yeah. days of AOL and sure. then we Zoom and whatever, you know, Facebook. Anyway, so Lawrence is one of those folks. I met him way back when I was in middle school or something, because he was black and interested in Japanese stuff. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I studied Japanese for many years. So, you know, we've talked about lots of stuff over the years. But at one point, we were just maybe on the phone or something, and he mentioned it offhand. And I asked him to tell me more. Lawrence, by the way, is from Oklahoma City, so he's not far from there. And I was shocked. This is when I'm, you know, 24, 25 years old. And as we continue to talk about, maybe I'll touch on this in the fourth movement. Folks erasing critical race theory from the curriculums. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what we're talking about. Just burying this news, burying this history. And then people have also been putting up the headlines from the next day. In mm-hmm. that area, that mm-hmm. read two white people killed in race mass and race riot or whatever it says.
And so there's a couple hundred.
There is
black
a
people.
Whole infrastructure that has been just demolished.
Right.
And the other thing, and we're going to get into this article, but the last thing that I want to say before while I'm thinking about it, I think this whole incident is a great example of how respectability, how quote unquote, just doing your job or whatever, if you are black, if you are a person of color, if you are a woman, can sometimes get you in it anyway, because we talk about how this started. A man named Dick Rowland was an elevator operator on the white side of town, and then something happened and he probably, you know, barely touched the woman. Mm-hmm. You know, but the elevator got jostled and bumped into her anyway. So, you know, by the time she's done screaming and telling all the good old boys, you know, what this black man didn't do to her, you know, and the rest is history, as they say. So there are layers and layers and layers of things here. And it's not even the only one. People have been passing around the map of all of the race. Right. You know, one from my hometown, 1866, you know, that we're still talking about slavery, but I didn't even know about that. And that's my hometown. So mm-hmm. just, you know, again, making sure that this history is remembered, not because we're trying to be divisive, but we can't come together if we aren't on the same page.
Right. Now, let me tell you something that I'm nervous about, because also among these stories, like the one that you will share on the page about from CNN, this mm-hmm. one that we're reading from, of interviews with people who say, yeah, I know about it, but I didn't think that it was that bad.
Right.
It didn't sound like it that bad. Wow. So my worry is that, as buried as this was, how are we going to do better about teaching that going forward so that it doesn't start to fade like the Holocaust deniers are saying? You know, that the further we get away from the event and the fewer people that we have that were there and remember and can, you know, relate these stories, it's going to evaporate into nothing forever, don't you think?
Yeah. And we have, and thank goodness for the music and the musicians, you know, doing their part to make sure all of this stuff is never forgotten. It always survives. One of the names that pops up in this CNN article close to the top is Adolphus Hale Stork. I'm going to mm-hmm. read a little bit. In his latest work, Tulsa, 1921, Pity These Ashes, Pity This Dust, with libretto by Herbert Woodward Martin, the story of those dark days is told by a young girl picking through the destruction and lamenting the extinguished hopes of a thriving, industrious black community. What do you think about, you know, when we talk about Mozart opera, these fantastical things, and then we get into Verdi and Puccini, and it gets a little bit more real, but it's still this fantasy thing. Is this the content you're going to go in the opera house for? We talk about trauma, mm-hmm. right, and reliving trauma. What do you think staging this sort of history in this way does for the memory of the history? Is this something that folks are going to go out to see? Would you want to go out to see it?
Well, this it's interesting you asked me that, because I was going to ask you something similar about, you know, the composer reliving that
or
re-experiencing it, you know. And this is a months-long process. Compositions take sometimes, right? Mm-hmm. So can you imagine living in that every day for a months-long project?
Yeah.
So where are we with that? Is it all right for a black composer to expose that pain in a production like this.
Let's just be real. At the end of the day, it's going to be mostly white people taking in this content,
right?
Because it's mostly white folks in the opera house.
Right.
If this is how they need to hear it, if this is how it connects, so be it. And I think Hale Stork understands that. We always talk about this multi-front battle when it comes to equity.
Uh-huh.
And I think this is Hale Stork's way of, you know, doing that for these folks. Well, he was quoted in this article. I was moved by it. He says, Hale Stork, "The survival of African Americans in this country is a story of survival. It deserves to be honored in the arts, on stage, in music. It's a noble story, and it needs to be told."
Mm-hmm.
So despite the destruction of communities and the oppression, the black codes, the Jim Crow, the way the police treat black people now, you know, we still manage to create art at the top level. We still manage to thrive in many ways. And Hale Stork is just saying that is, you know, a part of that American story.
Mm-hmm.
So again, why would you want to bury that if it's, you know, unless it's challenging to your sense of truth, to your sense of what it means to be America, that whiteness, and then challenging that further by taking this into the concert hall? I'm mixed because I'm not ready to go back into the concert hall at all.
Right, I know.
I'm glad that this is happening, and it really excites me that an avenue like CNN is paying attention to it.
Well, let me go back and answer the original question, because once you hit on the fact that the audience was key, then 100%, you know, the people that will be sitting there listening to the music are the ones that need to know the story.
Yeah.
So it's great for them. I feel bad for the composer having to pull that pain every day.
Yeah. Yeah. It's responsibility. Sometimes, you know, I won't speak for Hale Stork, of course, but, you know, a sense of duty,
mm-hmm,
in whatever we do in this work sort of, in my case, over, you know, trumps, for lack of a better term, those feelings of pain and trauma and all that. Maybe I'll bring that into my therapy session. We'll see.
Record it.
The woman who who premiered Pity These Ashes, the Hale Stork, is Janai Bridges, who, it says here on the CNN article, has been called the Beyonce of opera. I mean, what a...
Put that on your Twitter bio.
Grammy who? You know, Tony who? I'm the Beyonce of opera. So
right.
as affirmed by BET, you know, who else? So anyway, she's out here doing the good work. She premiered this piece of music, a quote from her here. It says, "What drew me was the storytelling and becoming a vessel to dive into these amazing stories. They reflect history. They reflect the most common and universal emotions. Tragedy, death, love, joy, heartbreak, jealousy, deceit. This music is for everyone." That last sentence, Scott, "This music is for everyone." What does that make you think about? What's your reaction to that idea?
This music is for everyone?
Yeah. I think it's bigger. I think it's bigger than even this piece of music. I hear Miss Bridges saying in that this music, this opera music, opera, classical music, so-called classical music, this is for everyone. And in music being for everyone, that means the subject matter has to touch a little bit of everyone, has to engage everyone, has to be relevant to everyone.
Mm-hmm.
And this is, even if we are just now learning about it, this is. And I think this is the exact direction that so-called classical music has to go as we're coming back outside. Not that it all has to be about trauma and how, you know, black folks have struggled, because as Hale Stork said, we've survived. But this music being for everyone, I think, means we have to do and see and hear more of this sort of thing.
What do you think the rest of the program would look like to really make it an event, make it an evening that you would go and sit for?
A Brahms concerto? maybe a Florence Price. Because, and then you can tie into that, excuse me, the trauma that she and her family went through leaving Arkansas and going up to Chicago, and, you know, saying they managed to escape, but so many didn't. Or, you know, there's always ways to...
Do you think that in an instance like this, there's the need for the spoonful of sugar to make the medicine go down?
That question is beginning to challenge me more and more. We all know that phrase, honey attracts more flies than vinegar, right?
Yep.
So if we got to attract the flies, whichever way I you brought it up. No, I'm not calling anybody a fly, but no, I guess that the so-called spoonful of sugar, if that's what it's going to take, if that's what it takes, so be it. Because there's so, as I mentioned before, there's so many places trying to continue to erase this history, erasing critical race theory, all of this stuff. So if a spoonful of sugar is what we have to do to protect this bit of history from being gone forever, so be it. So be it. Did I already give? Oh, I gave this a sharp. Let me press my sharp button again. Gave that a sharp.
Thank you.
And as we get into this next accidental, I thought we could actually hear from Miss Bridges. Here, this is an excerpt from a piece of music also on the Tulsa subject written by Daniel Bernard Romain. We talked a few weeks back about They Still Want to Kill Us. So who decided not to sing it, who chose not to sing it, and who did. Jenai Bridges was one of the folks who did comfortable with that. You remember that God Bless America, God Damn America, right, that whole thing. Anyway, so here's a little of Jenai performing a little bit of this as we get into this final accidental.
Burn it down, burn it all down.
She's got a great voice.
Burn it down and burn it all down, is what she said. We were kind of talking about that yesterday, that idea of moving the proverbial house as opposed to and moving it to make room for others as opposed to, you know, burning it down.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They talk, you know, people always talk to me about, well, it's not just about destroying it. It's about adding to an X, Y, and Z. If only the folks down there in Tulsa had that idea, huh? To not just burn it all down.
Yeah, well, it wouldn't have happened, right?
Anyway, for this final accidental, a part of me wants to give it a sharp, but I'm going to go ahead and press the flat button. This is from, who is this from? This is from the Washington Post.
Mm-hmm.
Longtime national arts leader retires amid accusations of hostile workplace and racial inequity.
How should we fix this headline?
Racial national retires amid accusation of hustle. I don't know. What would you do? Do you have an idea? I don't know. I think it tells the story.
Arts leader accused of a hostile workplace sinks back into the hedges.
Okay. I see what you're saying. I see. Yeah, I was kind of getting to that.
A retirement. Come on.
Well, we had the apology tour that people go on. I feel like we're getting to the retirement tour.
Mm.
Let me read a little bit of this. Again, this is from the Washington Post.
This is the part that kills me.
It says, Robert L. Lynch, the influential leader of Americans for the Arts, who has been on paid leave since December as his organization investigated complaints about racial inequity and a lack of diversity in the workplace, has agreed to retire as its president and chief executive of the board announced in a statement Thursday. For folks who aren't up on this sort of story. So member of the Trilloquy family, Quanice Floyd, has been keeping me updated on this. Long story short, Americans for the Arts has been dropping the ball. And we can talk about the bigger issues of how philanthropy is really dropping the ball in general. I think even inside of its gates, inside of its organization, folks were talking about racial inequity, how the system is fucked up, how Robert L. Lynch is not acting right. And they finally, you know, gotten them out of there. We can say, I think it's always interesting how we decide that people are retiring, but let's face it, they got him out of there. I think when you drum up enough information, when you drum up enough attention to a thing,
enough pressure,
you're going to have to do it. And that has not always been the case, but in this year of 2021, more and more people are beginning to be unafraid to really push until the change is made.
And remind me of Quanice's podcast, because she really pushes.
Mm-hmm, yeah, Quanice's podcast is called Arts Administration Bitch. Let me get that, because I think I got the title only halfway right last time. Where's my phone? Talk while I grab my phone.
talk while you get your phone about. You need to give me a little bit more warning when you do that.
Well, you said the part that had you about this article was that he was on paid leave. Why does that get you?
I would love to get in trouble and then sit home
and do nothing.
Mm-hmm. And get a paycheck to come in before I retire, because I've still got another 15, 20 years before I retire. So,
by the way, okay, Quanice's podcast is Black Arts Admin Bitch Podcast. So definitely go check that out. I'm actually going to be a guest on that here in a couple of weeks. So definitely go check that out. You say it's something for Robert Lynch, you know, up there being a racist, as they say, and being on paid leave. Do you know how much he's getting paid? Do you know how much he was getting paid? That's the part.
Just shy of $1 million.
Just shy, like something like $922,000. In this article, they talk about inside the investigations was looking at the PPP money, AFTGOT, Americans for the Arts, the other emergency grants and things, but they wouldn't say if any of that money went toward his almost $1 million salary.
Yeah,
so we're getting all these PPP loans that they need it so that he can, you know, continue to drive whatever car he's driving.
It kind of makes me wonder if he gets a percentage or if he gets a salary.
What you mean? What are you getting at?
Just talked about Joe Budden wanting to give a percentage, and they were questioning, you know, well, percentage of what?
Either way, it's too much.
So is $1 million a percentage or is it a salary?
I don't know. Good, great question. It's
sitting
too
home,
much.
Sitting home with a bag of chips and your Netflix.
Something else that I found interesting in this article, they were talking about the, let me think for a second. We got to the pay. We were talking about the pay. Scroll down a little bit. Maybe it'll pop back into my head. Some of the critics call for Lynch to resign immediately. No, scroll down a little bit more. Okay, here we go. Yeah, they're talking about how this PPP money went in, and I'm reading from the article here. AFTA's decision to not share the results of the investigation, so what people were saying about the racism and all of that stuff, was criticized by Caitlin Strokosh, president and CEO of the National Performance Network, a group dedicated to racial and cultural justice. Caitlin said that total lack of transparency and disinterest in accountability is about as AFTA as AFTA can get. They are so steeped in their own sense of power that they would not think that this is egregious. I think this is something really important, because we're also running out of time as we move forward with these organizations making their statements, and then it's all fine. The masses don't trust what those statements say. They don't trust these organizations. But as it's written here, arts organizations, large arts organizations that haven't had to be held accountable for all these years, are just so used to what they say is truth, is what goes, that they don't even understand how not telling us what happened, what came from this investigation. They don't even understand why that's a bad thing.
We've talked about this before, too, when we talked about an organization's response to something like this, and they feel like they're giving a satisfactory response or giving it in a way that they think will absolve them.
Yeah.
And instead, it just kind of knocks them down another foot in the hole they just dug for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
I think that happens all the time.
Yeah. Well, the moral of what's the moral of the story for you? We have someone in a very high position of power in the arts. I didn't mention it, but it does say in the article, Robert Lynch was a part of the transition team for, I think, Obama and Biden. So, you know, the arts arm of that. So this isn't somebody just working a job. This is somebody, you know, well established in the structure, in the system.
Yeah,
he fell from power. So
there was some diplomatic job that he was up for, or being secretary of something over the arts, I believe. I forget what it actually was, but that happened.
Do you have a word of encouragement for folks who are working in hostile environments? Do you have a word of warning for people who think they'll be able to slide under the radar? What's your general just you know, wrap up of this whole saga we've kind of been covering over the past few months.
I've said it before. Read it out loud before. Read the statement out loud before you press send.
Yeah, yeah. For me, I really want to shout out all of the people working these jobs in a place that you feel like is oppressive. I think it's so important to organize, whether formally, you know, with the union or not, just make sure that the conversation is being had. The conversation is being had in confidence because, you know, when we talk about these corporate systems, when something slips out, people slip out, right? Mm-hmm. So anyway, I hope this can be an example to all of us of how change can happen. I think a black man has been taking charge since Robert Lynch has been off the thing, and he's going to continue on. Someone from the military.
Military so. Man, yeah. Retired Army Brigadier General Nolan Bivens.
Yeah.
He's been pinch hitting in the position since the guy's been at home in December, since Lynch has been home. So,
well, everyone just stay in the battle. Stay in the battle and let this be an example. It is possible. No part of this machine is too powerful to continue on. And that's that. As we get into the second movement, where we will take the second ending, I'm going to talk about that here in a second. A slight change for movement three. I'm going to talk about the tune I have to pick is one as performed by Michael Jackson. I wanted to transition with a younger Michael Jackson performance, a tune called I Want to Be Where You Are. Do you know that one off the top of your head just
I
by
don't,
the title?
I'm sorry.
It's this really great tune. I think let me press play.
Is that a deep cut?
It starts with some harpsichord and oh there it is. And basically it's Michael Jackson just saying, look, I've been gone for a little bit. And now I'm back. I hope you're glad I'm back, because I'm glad to be back. That's how I feel for season 3 of Trilloquy. So here's a little bit of this.
Baby, I stayed away too long. Did I leave your mind when I was gone? It's not my thing trying to get back. But this time let me tell you where I'm at. You don't have to worry, because I'm coming back to where
I kind of want to keep it playing a little bit.
What era is this? This is Young Michael.
This
so
is
70s.
Young Mike. Yeah. The album has got to be there.
Hmm.
I mean, you got that harpsichord and I want to get to the I want to get to the hook. We can talk over it while it's getting there. Michael Jackson, just the young child doing all this musical stuff. It's full grown folks who can't sing this way, and we had a 12-year-old singing this. Listen. Anyway, we're in the second movement here, where we are taking the second ending. So what do I mean by the second ending?
Yeah, what do you mean by that?
In music, you have repeat bars, right?
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes those repeats are, I forget the actual word for something without multiple endings, maybe a clean repeat, or anyway, sometimes you go back and the end of that section you repeat is a little different, so you can go on. That's called taking the second ending. So I wanted to rename the second movement taking the second ending, because when I think about the music that over the week we may just repeat in our earbuds, repeat around the house, we're going back and we're going back, and this is our opportunity to take that second ending and talk a little bit about why we were repeating it so much, why we think it's an important tune, why we want to share it with the folks. So there you have it. Another season three update here. So the tune I want to talk about is called People Make the World Go Round. As you know, I'll, you know, smoke some weed and listen to music as a part of my day and sort of do a thing. And if I hear a tune that I really love, I try to break it down, try to get on the keyboard, put it on my instrument. That happened with this tune. I was listening to the Stylistics' Greatest Hits album.
Nice.
That I love so much. And I always stop. I think it's track 12 I stop at, because that track is You Are Everything. And that's my favorite tune by the Stylistics.
Mm.
But this day, this morning, I decided to just continue to let the record play. And it was a tune called People Make the World Go Round. Let me read a little bit about this because there's some younglings like me who may not know. This is from the Wikipedia. It says, People Make the World Go Round is a song written by Tom Bell and Linda Creed, originally recorded by the Stylistics and released in 1972. We're talking about music from the 70s. Here are a few of the opening lyrics. Trash men didn't get my trash today. Oh, why? Because they want more pay. Buses on strike want a raise in fare so they can help pollute the air. But that's what makes the world go round, the ups and downs, the carousel. I can go on, but you know, music back then really speaking to the times and not shying away and doing it with swag at the same time. We aren't talking about protest music that is just ugly or is just lackadaisical. We're talking about stuff that gets me in my two-step
right
here in the house. Anyway, I think the Stylistics version of this tune is so important to hear, especially for so-called classical people, because the orchestration of it, you have, this is ready, like somewhere is a score to this. It's so beautifully and lushly orchestrated. So shout out to the Stylistics. As was, you know, very common back then and still today, folks love to cover songs and flip songs. I was on YouTube and happened to hear the Michael Jackson version, and as we were saying, young Michael killing it. Let's hear him sing a little bit of this song, People Make the World Go Round.
Teachers on strike, no more school today. They want more money, but the board won't pay. Everybody's talking about ecology. The air's so polluted that it's hard to breathe.
Even in that one, you have some a little bit of marimba in there under Michael, and you have mixed meter. Mm-hmm. You have 4-4, 2-4, 4-4, or however they do it in the score. Such a great example of what we mean, again, by decolonizing that phrase, classical music. We have all of your orchestral, we have all of your Western orchestral instruments there. We have a musical tradition, a sound that is foundational to America and exists in its creation, at least nowhere else. That soul sound, you know, is there. This is a classic composition. And like your Brahmses and your Mozarts, it's been performed and flipped over and over again, as we see here by Michael Jackson. I cannot wait to go hear some sort of orchestral or any live instrumental version of that incredible song with an incredible message and a performance of it there that by Michael Jackson that had me press and repeat. So that's my that's how I took the second ending this week.
So you know how Mozart was prolific and talented right from an early age, and his father took him out, much like Michael's father took him and the brothers out.
I've had this discussion. Yep.
Oh, okay. So I don't need to go down this path.
Well, I mean, but for the people who don't know, the comparison that people make.
I was just curious if there's something there. About not getting a childhood, you know, because you're working, and obviously, look, it was paying off. You know, his talent and all of his work at a very young age was paying off, but did he have a crappy adult life because of that? You know, that's one of the things I wonder.
You know, there was some sort of song, maybe I can find it here quickly. There was a song that Michael Jackson put out, Where Was My Childhood, or...
Oh, I thought you were going to say Leave Me Alone.
That's a good one too. Yeah, I'm looking at it right here. And this is older Michael. Let me.
Have you seen my childhood?
You don't know this song?
I don't.
I'm searching for the world that I come from, 'cause I've been looking around in the lost.
Anyway, I'll put that on the Trilloquy Tracks playlist as well, but I think that's a good point. Sometimes I think about, do we deserve to really have this music? Because I'm bopping to young Michael and he didn't even get to do what a lot of children do. I think it's important to note that they were Jehovah's Witness, so Christmas and birthdays wouldn't have been a thing anyway. Wow. So it's not like the fame, you know, did that. But I think that is a very important thing to note. I don't think their parents did the wrong thing, because look at what he did for the world. We can say the same thing about my fave, Beyonce. You know, mm-hmm. she's been on the circuit since a very little girl. Sure. And look what she has done for the world. So I don't know.
No, I'm not trying to. I'm just saying it's an interesting correlation.
Yeah.
And also, I wonder about child prodigies, you know, getting ground up in this business before they're even a teenager.
Yeah. Sometimes not even child prodigies. Just think about the 14-year-old pianist who is just, you know, bleeding fingers at the keyboard to get into Tanglewood, which we'll talk about later, or Juilliard or whatever. So there's there are degrees to that everywhere.
Well, this kind of dovetails in with the music that I was listening to over and over and over last week, because I have to mention this again, that as we record this, this is the last day of Mental Health Awareness Month.
Yep.
And the 24th was the anniversary of my mother's death. Mm. And with everything that had been going on, and all the projects that I have going on around the house, I forgot about it. And when I remembered, all of us, it hit me like an elevator fell on me or something.
You forgot about the anniversary of
my mother's death. Yeah. And so then when it reminded me, what I did to cope with it was, you know how Chris Traeger on Parks and Recreation would ride his bike or do whatever task he could so that he didn't have to stop and think about his own crippling depression or whatever. So he was constantly running at a high rate, right? Well, I went out and dug and then cemented 8 post holes throughout the course of the day on Tuesday.
You were at it.
Right. And then I came inside and, you know, I'm thinking about Mom, and, you know, Radar had his surgery, and, you know, he's getting old and he's going through a transition, and I started getting emotional about that. And this song by Irving Berlin came to mind called What'll I Do? And in the version that Nat King Cole does, it's the great jazz standard, you know, sort of the all-American soundbook, you know, with some nice guitar there too.
Yeah.
But the way that he sings it makes you even feel off kilter.
What'll I do when you are far away?
It sort of limps, doesn't it? Now, I spent that night listening to every version of it that I could find online. And here's something interesting. Whenever I listen to a man sing it, I can get through it. But if I hear a woman singing it, like Judy Garland, her version, I'm in bits.
Or the famous B. Arthur, you know?
That's the one that really got me when she sang it. That was pretty amazing.
And I am blue. What'll I do?
Very nice.
So what will you do when fill in the blank is gone away? And all you have, what's the lyric? Dreams of, I have is dreams of you that
won't
come
true. What'll I do with just a photograph to tell my troubles to?
Yeah.
I think the answer is right there in the song. You ask, what do I do? What am I going to do in this situation? And then I started learning the chords on guitar, like a simplified version.
Yeah.
And so now it's kind of me and Radar's song. I've been singing it to him.
Oh.
Playing it on, and you know, he sits and listens. He's so attentive.
And so polite.
He is. So that was the one that I just kept going back to the last several days.
With only dreams of you that won't come true, what'll I do?
She did that so nice.
And I actually think that scene from Golden Girls is a great testament to what you were talking about. One of my mental health things, keeping up work to not have to, you know, face some of that depression. That song, that performance took place in the midst of a bar where you have Rue McClanahan's character. I can never remember, but Rue McClanahan. On the show, running around and being the character she is,
she's leading all the conga guys. Line.
In the midst of that, you know, you have those emotions. And when I think about the Golden Girls specifically, when I think about folks, you know, going into their golden age and having all of those memories, man, that song really does something.
It does. And I love the fact that after processing it and spending all those days going through all the different kinds of crying, that now I can listen to it and be okay. And I think that that's sort of a metaphor for this situation overall, that once you get through the uneasy portion, then maybe you will know what to do.
Yeah.
So I'm hopeful anyway.
Yeah. Well, something I'm thinking about right now to transition us into this third movement, you talk about the different types of crying, you know, what'll I do when you're gone and all these ideas. A couple of weeks ago, we had the 1 year anniversary of the death of George Floyd. And our personal experiences are one thing, being here in the Twin Cities this past year during it all. I'm sure there's nothing that we can say that compares to the feeling of the family to have their loved one gone.
In such a way.
So through that, there have been so many people coming up to bat to help them, to donate money, to facilitate things. And one of those folks was a rapper named Lil Baby. I know you know Da Baby.
I do.
I don't know if you know Lil Baby.
I don't.
So Among all the folks trying to help out, Lil Baby, the rapper Lil Baby, has been out here raising money, facilitated a way for the family to travel, to do different things. When the family went to the White House on the anniversary to talk to Joe Biden, Lil Baby was there because, you know, he was a part of that whole movement along with the lawyers, along with the advisors and all of the family. I think it really just shows how we traditionally, especially in this field of so-called classical music, have taken hip-hop and hip-hop music and put it in this corner as something that is violent or whatever. But we have folks in hip-hop really coming up to bat and doing what other folks won't, putting this money to work and helping us try to enact some change. Lil Baby is among those folks. Today's guest, Dr. Durell Cooper, we talk a little bit about the importance of hip-hop, what is black music again for June being Black Music Month, and what all of this can mean for the next generation. Will we really start respecting this art form, teaching this art form, the history and the stories behind it, and working toward liberation, which we get into. So to get us into my conversation with Dr. Durell Cooper, I thought I might play a little music by Lil Baby. Okay. Again, this is not Da Baby. Shout out to Da Baby.
I'm paying attention.
This is Lil Baby. Speaking to the moment, music, again, with the People Make the World Go Around, we're talking about 1970s. That music was speaking to the moment. Lil Baby's music speaks to the moment as well. This is a little bit of a tune of his called Social Distancing. Let's take a listen.
Since like this great cookie, motherfucker.
What's happening, TT?
I told her to fly and she's scared of the virus. I sent her a private to get here. I made $400 off each of these pounds. I ain't tripping, it's gonna be a good year. Solomon driving while I got my hands on the chopper. I'm keeping my eyes in the review. I'm
from I feel there, a lot of that. You know, this idea of giving back to the community is really what hip hop was birthed out of to begin with. You know, whether it was a block party or a cookout. You know, it really was about the community coming together in celebration of creativity and ingenuity and the beauty of the culture. I think, you know, fast forwarding to today, we do see some recording artists that have some very philanthropic elements to what it is that they do. you know, from Nipsey Hussle to Jaden Smith, you know, they all have found ways to be able to give back with not only their talent, but also with their time and their finances to communities that, you know, maybe not only listen to their music, but would also like assistance in other ways that makes sense. And so I'm all for it. With that being said, I would never expect or hope that any artist or person would push something that they didn't honestly and truly believe in and and honestly and truly stand for. So like, you know, this, like these performative, like Dr. Terry Watson calls it performative wokeness, but like these performative measures, these performative allyship, like measures to do things just to keep up appearances, I don't think is ever really helpful. But if it's genuine and it's authentic, and you're leading with a passion and you're focused on impact, and I'm all for artists using their platforms for causes that they sincerely care about.
That's an interesting concept, because that performative activism, when it comes to these Black artists who have all this money, I mean, it seems like even from that can be something positive. If they're performatively donating money to this family or this community, that community has still been positively impacted, right?
Absolutely. I think it kind of starts to fall more on like, you know, if the way I kind of look at the movement, like whatever that movement is for, you know, individual people, if your liberation isn't tied up to mine 110%, then I actually don't want your support, because your vibe will attract your tribe. I have no doubt about that. And so with that being said, there'll be some people that you will bring in and attract along the way. And then there'll be some people that, you know, that maybe don't go to the next level or to the next journey with you. But, you know, doing it for doing it's sake, at the end of the night, you know, you may be the one like having to question your actions on why you're doing these, you know, certain things. But, I mean, I guess there is something to be said for guilt money, right? I mean, that is definitely a thing that's out there, especially, yeah. I mean, philanthropy is built on that, like sure. Literally. And so that is a whole thing. But, you know, especially when you start talking about like philanthropy and white supremacy culture, we really have to really interrogate that and go, yeah. Okay, well, what are you really feeling guilty for? But I would, you know, I don't know. I always err on the side of encouraging people to stay as real as possible. And so it's like, you know, if you really care about it, you know, do it. If you sincerely care about it, do it. And if you don't, find something that you do, you know?
Yeah. You use that word liberation, and I think we sometimes take for granted what that means or what that would look like. We talk about it theoretically all the time. You said you need somebody to be 110% tied up in your liberation. How do you define that? How do you define that liberation?
I know. So for me, I believe it's liberation to and liberation from simultaneously. Mm. Right. And I also believe that like we as Black people, you know, we hear a lot now about Afrofuturism and like this idea of Black futures. Right. But Blackness not only is the future, but it has also been the past and it is also the present.
Yeah.
So this idea of liberation and it being tied to that, you know, the moves to make, right, or the decisions to make, it's, you know, you have to take into account the moment that we're in. You know, it is funny because you opened up talking about more like contemporary or current musicians, and it is most definitely like the moment that we're in, but then it's also what we're doing now and the ripple effects that it's going to have generations and generations and generations down. And if you're only making decisions, you know, regarding the fierce urgency of now based off of the present and not thinking about how this work is going to ripple, then it is a very short-sighted decision-making process when you start to think about this idea of liberation. Because liberation for us today may not be what is liberated, you know, 100 years from now, you know, because hopefully as time goes on, there's more access, there's more opportunity. So what are we doing today to provide that for someone else? And I feel like, you know, this is really where Kimberly Crenshaw and the idea of intersectionality really kind of came from to begin with, is because sometimes it wasn't quite a women's issue and sometimes it wasn't quite a Black issue, but it was most certainly a Black women's issue, right, when it kind of came to some of these things. And so really thinking, and then now today to even add, you know, additional context to it. What about the liberation of trans Black women?
Exactly.
You know, or trans women of color? So what are we doing to put, what are we putting in place to make sure that, you know, our idea of liberation is really a place where everyone is free and not just a place where you have certain privileges that are resembling that of the dominant culture.
Yeah, those intersectional conversations can be so challenging because I'm rooting for everybody Black. And as a Black queer person, there are certain experiences I have within our community. You know, there's a lot to that. Your words always get me thinking about other things. When you use the word generational, you're making me think about our last conversation. You really left me shook. I believe you said something along the lines of it takes 7 generations to change the thinking of a people. And when you said that to me, I started thinking about myself, and I think about how I am 6 generations from the plantation. It's really shorter than that, but 6 generations from as far back as we can reach, which, you know, of course, intersects with the plantation. Can you speak to that a little bit more? You know, everybody wasn't in on our previous conversation, just that concept of 7 generations to change the thinking of a people.
Absolutely. So that's really kind of stems from like indigenous wisdom. So cultures that were native to America before, you know, settlers started to show up. But this idea of 7 generations to heal is really what they say about that, and to be able to transform. And it, you know, if you start tracking it, we are now in that 7th generation and have been now for a little while. So what you'll probably consider millennials are that 7th generation.
Yeah.
And in that, I think what we see is like the advent and the support of technology that is helping to sort of advance some of these things. So like knowledge sharing, our ability to find out about historical elements of, you know, what you were even just talking about now, like genealogical roots and being able to trace that even more. The digital age in a lot of ways has, you know, created a knowledge and a resource sharing that has helped to accelerate this learning and this healing process that kind of needs to happen to get to the next, to get to the 8th generation and 9th and, you know, 10th and so forth and so on. And the idea is the energies from 7th generations back is now what we are feeling to be able to live in like sort of this sort of a place of abundance versus this more sort of scarcity mindset that they may have had to take on because of the circumstances at that time. And so it, in a lot of ways, you know, it's funny, like sometimes I see these memes, it's like, our ancestors would be flipping tables over that we're asking for seats at, you know? I think about it like, or shirts that say like, I am my ancestors' wildest dream. And I think about that sometimes. I'm like, okay. Like I see that, but I'm really thinking of like some people, like what would Harriet Tubman do today?
Ooh.
You know, what would Fannie Lou Hamer do today?
Yeah.
You know,
Nina Simone, even more contemporarily, she'd be on here cussing. She would be on TV cussing.
Right. The world wouldn't know what to do with something. Or if Nina Simone had a reality show.
Ooh.
And people really got to see what, you know, what her life was like. Or Aretha Franklin had a reality show at that time. You know, pay me in cash every time.
And so, had a pocketbook with her.
And so I think about that and I go, you know, what they were able to do with what they were given at that time was so critical and important to set the groundwork for us to be able to make the moves and do the work that we do now, which is all the more reason to do as much and, you know, to be as creative and to resist when called upon, to make it that much easier for the next generation to be able to live a more full life. You know, it's this idea of Robin Kelly calls like freedom dreaming, you know, and that's really what it is. It's like, you know, what really is that wildest imagination or wildest reality that you can imagine and see? And then how can you create it?
And so many of us are living that wildest dream, that wild imagination, while others of us are still fighting, still struggling. I can't help but to often think about the disparities within Black communities. You know, we have families who, you know, folks my age who are third, maybe even fourth generation college graduates and have established different things over the generations. And then we have folks, Black folks, who are still kept out, who are still not quite there, and, you know, making that generational turnover just last longer and longer. What are your ideas as far as closing that gap? How do we get more Black people on the same page, in the same position, to really push forward in this fight for liberation that we're going toward? We can't be liberated if we aren't educated. We can't be liberated if we don't have access. And so many of us do, while so many more of us still don't.
I agree. In some ways, like I think of like the Tulsa massacre, right? And I think
if that had survived,
right,
generations of Black wealth that could have been
that could have been, but also the different representations of what education looks like, what success looks like, what community looks like, what building looks like. I think to me, in a, you know, when I envision a fully, you know, liberated world or society, is not necessarily one in which everyone goes and gets all of the same things all at the same time, or even in the same ways. Mm-hmm. But it's the access to be able to live in the way in which you have imagined. So for some, everybody's not going to go and get a doctorate. And to them, that's not necessarily what they see as success, is being able to define themselves mostly by predominantly white institution standards of whether or not you have educationally reached some level of attainment.
Yeah.
You know, we have college dropouts who have gone on to become billionaires by starting tech companies, you know, or definitely multimillionaires.
Yeah.
So I think the freedom dreaming aspect in that is being able to, one, get proximate to the person, like, so, you know, a person that may not necessarily be feeling like they're living as imagined as they would want to be, and finding out what that is for them, you know, and it's because so much of what we define ourselves by and defines our success by is, one, the media and what it kind of shows us and tells us, but also like our expectations and what we're looking at other people and what they're doing and what they have, you know. And it's like, sometimes if we really kind of looked at what it was that we had, we would be like, oh, you know what, this is not, because there's definitely someone less fortunate out there.
Yeah.
But I think a fully liberated society is one in which, regardless of what that dream is for you, there is a pathways and avenues for you to be able to go and get it. And to your point, that is the piece that we know is missing. And it's not just an American, you know, issue that we're dealing with. It's a global issue that we're dealing with, but it's actually access to those things. You know, and we are still right here in America, and, you know, and Flint still ain't got clean water.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So how are we talking about, you know, going to University of Michigan, getting it and you don't have drinking water.
Mm-hmm.
So there's some like basic stuff that we really have to fix in order to, like, you know, build this house up, you know, 'cause right now the foundation is faulty in so many ways.
So when you talk about, again, that change in thinking, us living in that seventh generation, what changes in thinking have you seen? Have you seen a shift across the culture, across Black communities, that might get the car moving in that direction?
You know, it's so interesting that you asked that question. I feel like one conversation that keeps coming up more and more for me lately is about mindset. And it's about a scarcity mindset versus more of an abundant mindset. And I think what I'm starting to discover as I, you know, go and meet different people, who, you know, like yourself, who I admire the work, and, you know, I see, you know, the passion that is going in, and also the good that is being spread as a result of it. Those type of individuals usually kind of have a at least like a similarity, like one, like if there's like a thread that I kind of notice in, like, which is being around some really dope people, I'm just going to be honest, is that they have an abundant mindset when it comes to what giving back their talent back out into the world. So whether that's, you know, dancers, whether that's singers, whether that's actors, whether that's musicians, that want and desire to share that talent with the world And giving back in that abundant way has proven to be a thing. Now, the other aspect of that is actually to realizing that there's enough space for everybody and everybody's talent once you get up there. I feel like that's the other sort of side of that coin. That's that scarcity piece that some people still kind of take with them along their route. And that's the piece that I think gets a lot of people hung up because, you know, and that can be a hard mindset to break. I get it. You know, I really get it. But there really is, and your gift will make room for you.
Well, if anyone has given gifts, that abundant mindset, that giving something musical to the world, I feel like it's Black folks. If you just globally, not only, you know, here in the United States, to that, as we're here in Black Music Month now, I always affirm, certainly on this show, that all American music is Black. If you just really come down to the root of it, all American music is Black music. Now, with that being said and with that understood, how do you define Black music more specifically in the context of 2021? If someone's talking about Black music, what are you thinking about?
In the context of 2021?
Sure.
I would say anything that's got a little bop to it, because if you know what I mean, to put it in the most common terms, I can think of anything that's a vibe. Because if you go back to for real syncopated rhythm, you have to take it back to, you know, the drums. You know what I mean? You know, they were so anything when if you listen to something, it got a little bop. I don't care what they putting on top of it to call it, you know, pop music or, you know, whatever it is. If you listen to something with a little bop in it, then you need to thank Black musicians specifically for creating that and putting that vibe out into the universe. Because that bop, that little heartbeat that you feel, that is Black music, you know. And now it obviously there's different genres, and you know, some have taken that bop to a new level.
Yep.
You know, and some will still come along and remix that bop and take it to an even newer level.
Right.
But that understanding that soul music, that to me, that is Black music.
I appreciate that affirmation because, yes, we can talk about, you know, the William Grant Stills and the Margaret Bonzes and, you know, going up a few more decades. I remember getting into Lenny Kravitz because he was Black, you know, and that's, you know, not necessarily what a lot of people would call Black music, but he's Black and he's playing music. So with all of that, I appreciate the affirmation of that bop, as you say, that vibe, hip hop, because for so long, I think it was just sort of sidelined, despite how successful it was. It was coined as this dangerous thing, as this thing that's not really music. But as it's continued to develop over these 40 years, we see that it is the music of the world, at least right now in this moment. Did you ever think that this Black music, this hip hop, would be what it is today, this global movement?
I know it's like one of those things. Not to... you know, place any limitations or anything on it, but there's definitely some things that have happened since, like, I had originally started my dissertation 2 years ago that I was like, oh, this is amazing. Like, this, obviously this is the moment to really be studying it and like learning as it's in a growth phase. But like, I look at something like breaking now being a sport in the Olympics, you know, like who knew hip hop would make it this far?
Yep.
You know, so I look at something like that and go, I didn't see that one coming, right? So, and it is not to underestimate the genre. It's just what we're seeing is more possibilities as it ages and grows and becomes more accepted on a global stage. Just how limitless it really is, or how limitless it really can be. You know, we look at, you know, although, you know, no one is perfect, but we look at an artist like Jay-Z, who's really been able to kind of show how you can age within the game,
right,
and still be able to, you know, stay ahead of it. And you know, after so many years and make additional moves and like just continue to build. You know, so people are just now starting to lay certain roadmaps that kind of show what all the possibilities really are, you know, or LL Cool J, who really is still around, you know, it's still very relevant. You know, and then we just got the Universal Hip Hop Museum
right
in the Bronx. You know, I think they just officially broke ground this year in 2021, although they were doing like some soft opening stuff. And, you know, and so it's really in so many ways, it's really just getting started and expanding. But yes, I'm learning very quickly that anything is really possible.
Yeah, I feel like we're at one of those critical junctures where, as hip hop and other black music continues to evolve, we have to begin to really take those hard records concerning where we came from. You mentioned the hip hop museum up in New York. I think they're working on something down in Atlanta as well. As I think about, you know, hip hop history and what we should remember, I often find myself coming to the question, well, where should we start? Or where should a person who wants to learn about hip hop start? A lot of people that I really respect, whose scholarship that I honor, say that Wu-Tang is the start. That is where you should start listening to that music and then branch off from there. Do you agree with that? Do you think Wu-Tang is a great starting point for the person who knows nothing about hip hop but wants to learn everything?
They are definitely a great place to start. I'm a little bit more open and flexible. I feel like, you know, you will vibe with the right artist, and that the right artist is going to open up gateway. Like, mm-hmm. you know, hip hop can be a gateway drug into other, like, you know, just dope stuff. You know, it's just a dope wormhole that you can go down. You know, we often are going to encounter it at like young or younger ages, you know, mm-hmm. just depending on where you are, where you're growing up. And so I think, you know, we talked about this during one of our first conversations. You know, we both grew up in the South, and at a certain time period, you know, in the 90s, you know, late 90s. And one group that was huge at that time was 3-6 Mafia, especially in this, like Southeast region.
901, Memphis, Tennessee. Yeah.
Okay. And, you know, being in Alabama, I definitely knew who 3-6 Mafia was, and I definitely used to bump their album. And I remember When the Smoke Clears was one of the first albums that I could listen to from the intro all the way to the outro. And we're talking about like 20-something tracks and nothing but like fire. And I was like, whoa, this is insane. So, you know, we're going to kind of encounter it at a state like we, and this is the thing that's this is the thing. I'm so glad you asked this question. This is the thing I've been kind of like saying when I've been going on doing like guest lectures or something like mm-hmm. that. When people are like, "So why did you choose hip hop to like study?" You're like, "What?" And so my thing is like, you know, I didn't really choose hip hop. Hip hop chose me, and it's true. And so it's going to choose you. Like the right artist or the right song, the right thing. It's going to choose you. And when it chooses you, you're gonna know. You're gonna be like, "Oh, this artist just chose me to like." You know, be their entryway into it, to break me into like this boundless like genre.
Yeah, and I completely agree with that. Hip hop choosing you, because being black and being immersed in that, there's always going to be something that you gravitate to, something you vibe with. As you said, for me over the years, it's really been the women in hip hop. When I think about some of my earliest hip hop memories, those Saturday mornings where the TV is just on the music videos, I'm thinking about Queen Latifah. I'm Ooh. Thinking about UNITY. I'm thinking about Just Another Day, and you know, all of that sort of thing. Of course, fast forward to now, you mentioned 3-6 Mafia. When I listen to Megan Thee Stallion, all I hear is that Southern in the impact and influence. Gangsta Boo, La Chat, all those people. It's really strong, and I agree that we all gravitate to different things. Who is today's blueprint in your mind? If, you know, we can list off all of these names of the greats. You mentioned Hove, you know, we said Queen Latifah, and you know, we can mention Lauren and all these folks, Wu-Tang. Who is today's and I hate to frame it this way, but I will. Who's today's Mozart? Who's today's Beethoven when we're talking about hip hop? From your perspective, of course, because this is a barbershop argument, really, at the end of the day. But
I know, right? It's like top one, dead or alive.
Right, yeah.
You know, that's an interesting question. If I had to really think about just somebody who I felt really encompassed, you know, living through dual pandemics and like just making a way out of nothing and surviving it, I would actually have to say Cardi B, honestly.
Ooh,
sort of thinking about what you know, like hip hop as entrepreneurship,
mm-hmm. yeah,
and hip hop as leveraging the best tools of the time to make it work. You know, they were finding you know, getting turntables and being like, you know, things that they couldn't even afford. Hey, this is our opportunity during this, you know, blackout. Let me go grab, you know, so using the technology of the day, social media or you know, television, to really be able to put your voice out there and to really be able to move and influence culture. And I would say that that's probably one of the, and which is so interesting too, because, you know, we both know the troubling history hip hop has had with women.
Yeah.
You know,
and present, troubling present to an extent too.
Right. Right. Even more so, hello, Megan Thee Stallion, you know? So it's been a troubling history, but at the same time, I think if you look at patterns of how to take what, no matter where it is that you're coming from, how to take what it is that you've been given and build a life for yourself within, you know, hip hop, that's probably one of the best modern examples that I can think of.
Yeah. Hip hop and other Black music is not only a means of realizing this imagination that we've talked about, it's the realization, it's the evolution of what is most classical to the United States, to America. We, you know, talk often about the Negro spiritual being that seed, being that foundation, you know, aside from, you know, what indigenous people codified. There's nothing else that was really born here musically other than that. So as that evolved into the blues and into the jazz and all these other stuff, you hear those motifs in all sorts of genres, and we finally get to hip hop. I can't help but to consider hip hop a part of that classic tradition, a classical music. And I know a lot of people are still just really confused by that assertion, but that's just how I see it. I see hip hop as American classical music. Is that a reach? Is that inappropriate? What do you think about that?
No, I don't think that's a reach at all. I think I think you're right right there with it, because I do think that hip hop, I think you can draw a direct line from hip hop today all the way back to griots and story circles, you know,
even before the spiritual,
before the spiritual. I think there's connections even before the spiritual, especially when you think about the drum, you know. I think it's connection, but especially when you get to the spirituals, oh my goodness, there's this book by Thomas Weber, Deep Like the River. Right. And basically it's called Deep Like the River, Lessons in the Slave Quarters. So it just talks about, it has different songs and hymns that the slaves would come up with, like, and the enslaved Black people would come up with while they were out in the fields working, or what, you know, during off and in between times. And so, and when you start to read some of these, what you start to see, like, and some of it, they're like, you know, even making fun of the slave master, like, yeah, in the songs, you know, talking about old Charlie dressed like this, you know, like different stuff like that.
Yeah. They were roasting the slave master.
Right. And so it's like, do you know the swag that it takes, the bravioso that it takes to be an enslaved people and still look and go, if I had what you had, I would still do it better than you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That is a powerful idea.
And that to me is hip hop. And so, yeah, there's definitely ties to it there. But yeah, there's a direct line that goes all the way back. Yeah, hip hop, you know, it's for real. It's a for real movement. And it's, you know, it's not going anywhere anytime soon.
As educators and other folks try to connect with communities that they haven't always, I feel like hip hop or hip hop adjacent things is that bridge, you know, matching hip hop with history, matching hip hop with, you know, the orchestra or whatever, that just being that conduit. Is that appropriate? Is that something that we need to be wary of? And I'll tack this on. The last time we talked, you put me onto this book for white folks who teach in the hood, and the rest of y'all too. You know, I haven't gotten into the book yet, but just reading the preface and stuff, it gets these thoughts going. Is that a cheap way in? I know we can talk about cultural appropriation, but there has to be something in there as far as pressing the needle forward, getting so-called classical music to more folks, and using hip hop, what we know, what is us, as that bridge, as that conduit.
I absolutely agree. And yes, shout out to Dr. Christopher Emden. Mm-hmm. He is an OG in the game for sure. Associate professor at Columbia and author for White Folks Who Teach in the Hood. He was also on my dissertation committee, which was an amazing honor. Thank you, you know, for allowing me to touch the hem of that garment. But yeah, I agree, you know, but it's that. And then there's the other part of it too, that I think about sometimes. It's how much energy are we going to put into the educating of other, mm-hmm. right? And how much of it is
And before
is
we
now,
get too far, let's clear that up. When you say how much time we are going to put into educating the other, are you talking about Black folks educating non-Black people? Well, what are you getting at there?
Yes. So that would be Black people educating non-Black people, especially when it comes to like our, you know, our culture or, you know, traditions and things like that. It's like, how much energy are we putting into that? And how much energy is or should be going into building up our own institutions, building up our own tables, you know, for lack of a better word, in order to do the work and the things that we're doing, you know, especially because a lot of it, like I think about now as a bridge, and I thinking about it, like this idea of a bridge, absolutely. Yes, we can create frameworks that can then go to different school districts that they can implement and use. And we should be doing that, you know, especially to get us to where it is that we need to go. But it is definitely a means to an end, and it is not in and of itself the end. I think to me the end goal is living in a situation where a young person of color, their intuitional knowledge is valued equally, or if not more so, than institutional knowledge. So what it is that they've picked up at a school, or you know, at a job site or work, like what they come into that you know, being birthed, especially out of like sort of this hip hop culture.
Yeah,
what they're coming into the classroom with that, you know, where's the genius at in that? Because if they can memorize all these like little baby lyrics, mm-hmm. but they're not memorizing that monologue in class, what is that, right? And shouldn't that be equally as valued, you know, or if not highlighted even more? So what is that intelligence there?
And I feel like, you know, we take for I'm thinking about, you know, growing up and my mom saying, oh, y'all know every word to that rap song, but I bet you can't say your Bible verse or whatever, you know.
Exactly. Or your ABCs.
Right. Well, not they can't say the ABCs, but can rap. But anyway, that's interesting.
You'll
to
be
me.
Surprised, especially with these mumble rap songs now. I show this video sometimes of this 2-year-old named Khalil who just kind of goes off on the flow with like him and like this older dog. Yes, I should pull it up right now. And like, I'll send it to you though. He's just going off. You can't understand a word that he's saying, but you see him right in on the pocket, on the beat. He's a da 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 da. He's right on beat. But yeah, I was going to say,
they're making hip hop for the nursery. They go, I guess my point is, there is something to that. It's not like kids are just sitting down, just trying to memorize this stuff. There's something about it that really connects. I love, you know, anytime I'm in a public space, at least before the pandemic, anytime I was in a public space and Chicken Heads came on, for example, you know, getting back to Project Pat and all that stuff, you can always find the folks in the room who can rap, myself included, who can rap every single lyric. After all of these years, it's probably been more than 20 years, but it's still ingrained. So I think, you know, it's important to make the point that it's more than just trying to make these superficial connections. There has to be something cognitive there about it for it to stick like that, for it to be up and stuck, as Cardi B has been saying lately.
Absolutely. And honestly, that is the for real key to it. Like, if you're going to do it, don't just, you know, oh, you know, I want to be a cool, like, especially if we're talking about educators, right? Mm-hmm. Don't just go, oh, you know, I want to be a cool teacher, so I'm gonna play hip hop as the students come into my room, and now we about to make them all learn from this Eurocentric you know, textbook.
Right.
Like that.
Like, we're not gonna rap Shakespeare.
That some so that's still creating that cognitive dissonance there. And so like the title of my dissertation was actually called Socially Distant. And that's mm-hmm. exactly the reason why, because, you know, when all this stuff, you know, came about with the coronavirus pandemic, and then there were like social distancing rules, I kind of looked at that and I said, you know, it's not really all that different than sort of the school's policies when it comes to, you know, especially young Black people, like within these spaces, they've been pretty socially distant. I mean, they intellectually or institutionally, they've been close,
yeah.
You know, one in proximity, but also in like indoctrination culture. But as far as like actually like the social element of it, like there's a for real disconnect between home, community, school, and in a lot of places still. And so that is the key. It has to be integrated into the things that you do. Like, you're in a math class, and you know you're in a geometry class, and what you're looking at is like scale, you know, or an architecture.
Mm-hmm.
Well, instead of just showing them like a building that's casting a shadow, and then go, you know, figure out, I don't know, it's a conference or whatever it is, you know, why couldn't you also do the same thing with like a wall and a sketch pad, you know, looking at like maybe graffiti art?
Yeah.
Thinking about what scale it takes to be able to blow this, you know, drawing on this paper up into like a 30 by 30 foot wall, you know, because doesn't it take the exact same skills to be able to do that?
Yeah.
So yeah, play the hip hop music as they come in into this geometry class, but then don't just go and start showing them like, you know, little images of like, you know, people trying to figure it out that does not represent them in any sort of way. So
And even the content, I can't remember the rapper who did it now, but I'm thinking about a lyric talking about something like whipping up pies. That's 360. You know, there's a lot there. Right. You know, there's a lot cultural there, and there's some geometry in there as well. So as a newly affirmed doctor of education, I know that you have a lot of work ahead of you, but I'm sure a lot of that is continuing a lot of the work that you've already been doing, including the Cultural Innovation Group. How about you tell the folks a little bit about what that is and what your plans are for Cultural Innovation Group moving forward?
Oh, wow. Thank you so much for that opportunity. So yeah, that's a boutique consulting agency that I founded in 2018. I started that company right around the time I started going back to school. At that time, I was like, I want to go and get a doctorate to help me do, you know, research projects in the field, because what I was seeing was that a lot of the companies that were getting, you know, some of these research contracts were going to predominantly white organizations to go in and study, you know, Black and brown children, mostly because I was looking at a lot of education research. So I'm like, how are you going to tell me that you're more of an expert on, you know, people and culture, especially my people in my culture than I am, right? But I understood that some of that was because of the educational attainment that they've been able to have. And so I started a company initially as thinking of it as like more of a research firm. While doing that, I went, okay, this is interesting, but there's still so many other programmatic things that I would like to fix too. And so then I started consulting with organizations on things like theory of change, strategic management, looking at JEDI or Justice, Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion initiatives and how they could be more embedded into the organization. I started doing trainings for both like nonprofit and corporate clients on things like intersectionality. And it's not to like go out and, you know, I have to teach everybody like these things and like teaching them about culture or teaching them. It's not so much that I do it for those reasons. I feel like this is the work that I'm being called to do. And I'm putting this work out. So if you feel like you are about that work and you're about that movement, then, you know, follow me. Right. And find other people that are out there like that. Read books, listen to podcasts like this. Do whatever it is that you need to do to get to that next level. I'm doing this because, you know, I feel called to it. You know, I'm passionate about it. I love doing it. But, you know, I'm not doing it because I feel like, oh, I got to go out there and teach, you know, other people about my culture.
Mm-hmm.
That's not why I do the work. It's also not why I teach. You know, I'm an adjunct instructor as well at New York University and City College here in the city. And that work is very much so the same. It's what we said, you know, earlier about giving back for these seven generations later, you know, recording these things and then putting them out there. But so the company is really kind of focused on that right now. So it's building these sort of boutique opportunities and clientele to really you know, aid in sort of like this movement towards like a better, more realized future. And so, you know, there's also some creative projects. I have my web series called Flow, where I go around and I talk to different Black people who are really doing some incredible work in multiple fields. So, you know, not just hip hop and or the arts. You know, we're also looking at science, which some can argue is an art. You know, we're looking at politics, we're looking at education. And so, you know, doing as much as I can with all of these things, man. And keeping it moving forward, I guess, mostly in that direction.
Yeah. How can folks learn more about all these projects? How can they follow you, reach out to you, all of that?
Absolutely. Probably, I would say, I go to Instagram. So Cultural Innovation Group on there. Also, my website, culturalinnovationgroup.org. Find me on Twitter, Cultural LLC. It's all out there for sure. You know, or Google me, Google Durell Cooper.
You're everywhere. Dr.
Durell
You're everywhere.
Cooper. You know, and hopefully, hopefully you will hear some stuff that, you know, you can use and, you know, things that you can't, but hopefully the things that you can, it can be very helpful and can at least get you on the right foot with advocating for the things that you might want.
Yeah. You have me really curious about this actual mumble rap, this baby rapping. So I think I'll outro with a little bit of that. But before I let you go, I just, you know, I had one more question. You know, as I think about how we've gone from the spiritual to hip hop, how we've gone from the plantation to private jets, so to speak, maybe that's a bar.
No, that is a bar.
We've bear witness to what is possible. We see what is possible for so many of us, sort of as we were speaking to before, that possibility, that imagination just seems so far out of reach still. What are your words to, you know, the folks struggling to realize their best self, their, you know, imagination, fully realized self? What are your words to those folks just trying to press through and get us closer to that liberation?
Don't give up. That I would definitely start there. Don't give up. And don't be afraid to be an original. And if there's somebody out there that you admire and that you really look up to and you know, from the past or the present, don't be afraid to remix them in some sort of way to invent, you know, the you would prefer to be, but don't give up. And if you need something more practical, try to find your tribe, you know, because they are out there and wanting to support you, you know, hopefully, and keep vibing until you do.
That is a baby rapping, not da baby and not little baby.
A baby.
But a baby. Shout out to, I'm going to get this name wrong. This is Khalil Eloyi rapping. This is from the video was 2011 when Lil Khalil was 2 years old. So I'm sure his whole family looks back to this and just, you know, it's something. You know, one of the things I was talking to Dr. Cooper about was how cognitive so many things are, and we spend so much time teaching our elementary school kids, trying to teach some of these adults as well rhythm. You know,
I'm there.
Steady beat, you know, really, really being into
flow.
The groove of it. Flow. That 2 year old had all of that. Mm. And hip hop is the way that happens. So when we talk about education, when we talk about liberation, we have to begin to accept the fact that this black music, this music that is foundational to America, can be used for so much more. That 2 year old wasn't talking about bitches and hoes. That 2 year old wasn't talking about money and guns and
but
all that.
But it was
stuff.
Crucial. Whatever he
right,
was believing.
Right. I agree with all points.
Yes.
that you know, again, it's about that flow and it's just about the idea. So when it's time for that baby to add lyrics to that, you know, to that mumble rap, we talk about mumble rap, right? to add some lyrics to that, the flow, the rhythm, the feeling, all of that stuff is there. That video will be linked in the description of this. But anyway, shout out to Dr. Durell Cooper. Thank you so much for coming on to Trilloquy. And as soon as I can find my Trilloquy tune, okay, here we go. We're going to get into the fourth movement. You ready for the Trilloquy sound?
I can't wait.
It's simple. It's just a trill. Here we go. Well, I have to be in the program. Okay, here we go.
On
nice
your toes
trill
yet.
There. Okay, here in the final movement, for folks who are new, we take a couple things that are going out there and present them to you as trill as we can. Not sugarcoating things, not, you know, putting a nice bow on it, just delivering it. I want to, and we've been off for 2 weeks, so of course there have been many things. I can't get to everything.
Right.
It's a lot of problems. I want to just talk about a couple of things that stood out to me over these past 2 weeks. So first and foremost, in the description, I will link an image of a cartoon produced by NPR Classical, National Public Radio Classical. We have a woman, clearly a woman of color here, who is pregnant. It looks like she's going into labor, and her caption is, "Honey, I think it's time." The white man at the laptop, sitting down, not paying attention to this woman of color in labor, says, "Can I wait 10 minutes? Tanglewood tickets are about to go on sale." Scott, react.
I will be honest and tell you that at first glance, I didn't catch the problem.
Okay.
Meaning that I wasn't thinking about how black women are sometimes ignored, and especially when it comes to medical issues.
Yeah.
That thought didn't come to mind. I just thought that it wasn't very funny. I mean, that Tanglewood tickets?
We have a lived reality. I'm not going to go on Google and look up the statistics, but it is real out here for black women and other women of color when it comes to childbirth, when it comes to access mm-hmm. to equitable health care. This isn't even a joke that I think should be made. If anything, I think it sort of highlights one of the problems that we're talking about. We have a white man in here paying more attention to so-called classical music and ignoring the problems that are directly around us for the sake of it.
Mm-hmm.
Clearly, we talk about who is in the room and who isn't in the room. Clearly, someone was not in the room. I doubt any woman was in the room to make light of that sort of thing. But you know. It is what it is. I hope that the folks, I made a stink about it over on Twitter, you know, because I'm good.
How did that go?
Well, I was going to say, I'm good at getting more engagements than the original thing. So you're trying to be cool unsuccessfully on Twitter anyway with 2 to 4 engagements, and then you're trying to be funny on top of it and dropping the ball.
I am not surprised, because I have seen you go into interviews where you're being interviewed and you turn it around on the other person. So
I need to do better about that. But
I just didn't think it was that funny.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not.
It's not that funny at best. At worst, it's violent. It's a bit misogynistic. I would even throw racism in. It's just tone deaf. The room was not read. So.
But it might be meta here, because look at one of the comments. A woman shares a story about going into the bathroom, her water breaks. She comes back out and says, "We need to go. My water broke." His reply was, "I just ordered wine."
I am tired.
So
he was probably drinking wine by himself at the table if she's 9 months pregnant. I mean,
yeah.
You know.
Did he get a solo cup for the ride to the hospital?
And then folks get mad when people say men ain't shit. But anyway.
I am one of them.
I gotta get quicker about that. You know, people get mad when women say men ain't shit. Anyway, that's the first trilloquy. Let's get to this next trilloquy, if you can.
Yeah, I'm falling down on the job here.
Yeah, no, you're fine. So speaking of Twitter, okay. Somebody tweeted something quite inappropriately. A very famous sax player, a sax player that I've performed with multiple occasions, tweeted the following. "Don't get me wrong. I'm all in for Florence Price symphonies, but I'm pretty sure calls for greater inclusivity were meant for living composers." Boy, they tow him up.
Where's your buzzer button? Your incorrect answer.
Oh, I need. Oh, that's what I need. Let's go ahead and give him the flat for now.
Yeah, no, that's not what they were talking about. Next.
this was interesting to me, because the story that I tell a lot of people is that where my journey started trying to change the aesthetics of classical music, so-called classical music, it was with new music. It was with the living composers. Mm-hmm. It's through that that I discovered that there are so many women composers and black composers that we never even know about. So from there, that's when I'm going back historically and I'm finding the William Grant Stills and the Margaret Bonds, Florence Price and them. So I understand what Timothy McAllister, my bad, I said your name. I understand what Timothy McAllister meant. But that is not what he said. Mm-hmm. He said, I'm pretty sure calls for greater inclusivity were meant for living composers. So the implication of this tweet is that it's time for us to forego the Florence Price symphonies. Don't get me on the orchestra roster websites. Mm. It's going to be Brahms and Beethoven all 2021 and 2022. It is not time to sideline any woman composer and certainly not any black woman composer. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, I mean, again, as you say, read it before you hit send. Read it before, you know, read it before you publish. A lot of the critics are saying, well, classical music, we need to stop trying to act like we are participating in cancel culture and y'all knew what he meant and X, Y, and Z. What do you think about specifically responses to tweets like this? Is it wrong for somebody to be upset?
I was just about to say, I'd like to see what the follow-up was.
There was some follow-up. There, yeah. You should go on his Twitter and look. Right. I mean, lots of apologies. Again, the apology tour, okay, a couple threads on Facebook.
But was it legit? Did you believe it?
I believed it. It doesn't take away what was said. And I think there has to be just an acknowledgement that you fucked up, that you said something wrong. And maybe some of us understand what you meant. I don't really think that matters. I think an acknowledgement of why this is wrong and doing something about that other than just tweeting your apology is necessary. We're talking about saxophones. We're talking about Black Music Month. If anybody can play a saxophone. Mm-hmm. Is who, you know?
Right.
We black people can do that job, okay? So don't take for granted that you are replaceable. We are all replaceable to an extent, but when we're talking about white men and so-called classical music trying to sideline Florence Price, he doing good not to have been there with Robert Lynch as far as I'm concerned.
Whenever I'm presented with a situation like this and I get an apology that I don't buy, I say, well, sorry, don't feed the bulldog.
Joe, don't.
See?
Last thing I want to get to before we close out. This isn't classical music specific, but I think it's so important. So across the South, and even I think like in Montana, Idaho, those places, critical race theory is under attack. It's gone in Tennessee now, too. They're trying to make it to where so much of American history, so much of our history, and when I say our, I mean all of our history, that is all of our history as Americans, it's being pushed under the rug. I almost don't know what to say about it because folks know my opinion. Folks know our opinion on it. I think what I try to get at, I guess even to connect it to classical music, is that we have the opportunity in the arts to make sure that this history is not lost. Tennessee, Idaho, Mississippi, all of these states, Texas, talking about indentured servants instead of slaves, instead of enslaved workers. Africans, those mm-hmm. terms that they were used instead of saying the truth, enslaved right. Africans. That gets into people's cognition and into the culture.
And then it's generational.
We have already acknowledged that none of us learned about Tulsa
right.
in high school. So they're trying to erase so much more of that. So that is why we have to use music. We have to use music and take the opportunity to remember. We have to understand what William Grant Still was talking about when he wrote his second symphony and subtitled it a Song of a New Race. You know, that fourth symphony, the Autochthonous Symphony, that's a word a lot of people don't know. Basically, it gets to something being created in a space. There is nowhere else for us to go. There is nowhere else that these stories exist musically. You know, when we talk about the Negro spiritual and all the other black music that came from it, when we talk about the oppression and the struggle that we have been fighting, you know, for 400 years now, when we talk about the victories along the way, you know, all of that is a part of the story, and taking away any part of it is so violent. And if any of us are going to allege to be on the right side of history, we have to do everything we can to make sure this history is not being forgotten. On the music front, that's happening everywhere. We have to make sure it's happening beyond music, because it's not going to be anything before, you know, those stories are gone forever. All right, well, are we about done?
No, I thought you were getting ready to hit the gong button. I thought you were on a roll there.
So all right, well, again, thank you everyone for tuning in to episode 1 of season 3. Great to have you here. We're switching up the feel a little bit, trying to be a little looser, a little bit more live to tape. So really appreciate you. Before I hit this gong, free Palestine.